This is Coding Math, episode 24, 3D Points and Lines. We ended off last week with a few examples of 2.5D, or postcards in space, which were expansions on the 3D carousel theme. In this episode, we start to transition to the full third dimension. Let's start off by recreating one of those examples, the 3D spiral you see here. And here's the code, as I left it in the GitHub repo last week. It's just adapted from the original postcard example, so it needs a little cleanup, and I'll do that as I go through and explain what's happening here. First of all, we have an empty cards array and a variable called numCards set to 200. Since we're not actually using postcards right now, I'm going to do some search and replace action to change cards into points. Now the center Z is 2000, and the radius that the points move around is 1000. And again, we have a base angle and rotation speed. Here I'm creating the points in a loop. Each point gets an angle of 0.2 times I, which, with 200 points, will arrange them around in a full circle several times. The Y is calculated so that the points will be evenly distributed from 2000 to minus 2000. And we have this leftover image property here that we can just get rid of. Each point's X and Z is calculated with basic trig, just like the postcards example, and the point is pushed onto the array. The context is translated to center screen, and we can clean up this leftover font line as we're not drawing any text here. The mouse move handler for setting rotation speed has no changes either. Then we go into the update function. Now, because the points are just black dots, there's no need to do any Z sorting now, so away that goes. The only other change in the update method from the postcards version is that instead of drawing images, we're drawing a small black circle. Finally, since we're not using the Z sorting function at this point, we just shoot that off into the land of deleted code. Now let's just test that again to make sure we didn't bust it all up. All right, that looks good enough. Now while we've escaped the postcards and space metaphor here, we're still really only doing 2.5D. If you consider that the circles here are two-dimensional disks, you're always just seeing the front of the disk, never seeing it turn on edge as it's moving around the circle. Personally, I really like the look of this type of 3D. Because it's all a single color, black, your brain easily sees it as more of a sphere than a disk. And again, you don't have to bother with Z-sorting. Things just kind of merge together. It's a nice, clean, minimalistic look. But actually, let me show you a quick hack you can do to kind of get the disks flipping around. Just before drawing the arc, I'll throw in another context scale line. On the x-axis, I'll scale the content by the sine of the point's angle plus the base angle. And the y-axis, I'll just leave as 1. I'll also up the radius of the circles. Now, a sine will vary from 1 to 0 to minus 1 and back through 0 to 1. This code will make it so the circles would be scaled down to 0 on the x-axis when they're on the far right and left of their path, and full scale when at the very front or back. This scaling is, of course, after the perspective scaling. And this gives you something that looks like this. It's not perfect, which is why I call it a quick hack. It doesn't look quite right, but it's an interesting and easy effect, and with a bit of tweaking, it might be right for some project. But all that's just an aside, a little bonus for you. Maybe you'll find a good use for it somewhere. I'm going to delete it for right now. Now, in order to move into full 3D, we'll have to abandon the idea of drawing 2D images or basic 2D shapes and start constructing and rendering 3D models of objects. In the most basic form of 3D modeling, objects are constructed of vertices. A vertice is just a 3D point. Those vertices are usually connected to form polygons. The simplest type of polygon is just a triangle made up of three vertices. Those vertices and polygons can then have properties applied to them, like color, shaders, textures, bump maps, reflection maps, etc. All kinds of things to aid in accurate and realistic rendering. Well, we're almost partway to the first step now. We do have an array of points. We can just consider that those points are actually vertices. If we stop rendering them as 40 pixel radius circle objects and change them to very small dots, it'll be a little more obvious that they're simply points in space. Here I've cranked the radius down to about 5. You might have a hard time seeing this if you're not in full screen mode, but what we have now looks more like points rather than 2D shapes moving around. The next step is to start connecting the dots. Rather than worrying about polygons and triangles for now, let's just connect all the points with lines. And while we're at it, we'll just stop drawing the points altogether. So the points won't be visible at all anymore, they'll just be used to draw the line. I'll start out here by beginning a path before the for loop, after the canvas is cleared. Now, if we're on the first point, I want to do a move to. Otherwise, I want to do a line to. So I'll just do an if-else, checking if I equals 0. Now, in both the move to and line to, I'm going to use 0, 0 as coordinates. This may seem odd, but remember that we've translated and scaled the context so that 0, 0 is the screen position of the current point. That's exactly where we've been drawing the circles, so that'll be where we draw the lines to as well. Now, since we're all into lines now and not so much into 2D shapes anymore, we'll just get rid of this arc drawing stuff. Finally, we just call context stroke after the for loop to complete our masterpiece. And what does this give us? Whoa, that ain't no postcard, I'll tell you that much. What we have here is a 3D spiral line. The points are no longer postcards, they're just coordinates used to create a 3D model. Points themselves are no longer rendered, just the lines that make up the model. We can make it a bit more interesting by varying the y value here. I'll just add a math random times 500 to each point's y when it's created. And let's see how that looks. Pretty nifty, I'd say. Actually, I'm a big fan of this wireframe 3D type rendering as well. But that's me, I was always a big fan of any vector-based video games as well. Your mileage may vary. But that's all we're going to do this week. There's a lot to cover before we're actually really rendering 3D objects, so we're just going to take it one bite-sized piece at a time. See you next week.